You turn with us to the book of Genesis, chapter number 39. It is our custom here that we stand and honor the reading of the Word of God found in the book of Genesis, chapter number 39, verse number 1. Joseph is a type in the Bible of our Christ. What a wonderful study about Joseph. Here the Bible says in Genesis 39 and verse 1, "And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian, and his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight and served him. And he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had he put into his hand. It came to pass from the time that he had made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house," look here, "for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field." What a great day that Joseph walked in his life. Many times I've found that we're not only blessed from who we are, but most of the time we're blessed by others. He left, verse 6, all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught that he had save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." So Joseph did the right thing. But he refused and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master, what if not what is with me in the house? And he hath committed all that he hath to my hand." Now verse 9 is where I want to pick up out of our series on the home this morning. "And he said, there is none greater in this house than I. Neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. How then," here's my thought, "can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" You may be seated this morning. There's a phrase there that caught my heart this week where Joseph said these words in verse 9. Now this is what has happened. Joseph was the favorite child. Joseph's brothers became jealous and envious of him, and so they sold him. They left him in a pit as dead. God got Joseph out of the pit and blessed him, put him into a place, and now Potiphar has recognized that it's something special about Joseph. He put him in his kingdom, put him in oversight of everything he had, And now he's back in Potiphar's house. Potiphar's gone. And his wife comes to Joseph and says, lay with me. And Joseph says this phrase, how then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And I want to preach on this thought this morning, on the man of I do. The man of I do. He said, how can I do? Fellas, do you remember saying I do? I've performed several services where man and woman would come together, and in those phrases he would reply, I do. I want to say that today America is struggling so because of the lack of the stability in our home. There's two things that every woman in this building needs in her life as she sets up her home and her marriage. She needs stability and she needs security. And therefore, in this I do of marriage, I want to talk about three things today and I'll be through. I want to talk, first of all, about the hand of I do. Then I want to talk about the heart of I do. Then lastly, I want to talk about the home of I do. Father, we love you today. And I thank you for this time together. Lord, we want to thank you that you've been in our presence today through that of song, through that of fellowship and prayer. Lord, realizing that I'm a needy creature this morning, God, I'm so very human. I need you to help me to be a blessing and to preach your word right today. Help our homes and our church, in our community and in our country. Lord, help us today as we preach. And I'll be careful to honor you and give you the glory for it. In Jesus' name I pray and I ask you, amen and amen. Now, the man of I do is what I'm preaching on this morning. The man of I do. But then the next time I preach, I want to preach on the woman of I will. Some of y'all get that tomorrow evening about 4:00. Now the man says I do. You know why? Because he respects those vows. And when a man respects his wife, then she simply does what God made her to do. She responds. And maybe the reason your wife is not responding to you, maybe you're not respecting what God put in place for you to be doing. I want to say that marriage is a work in process. And this December, we'll be married 37 years, and I want to tell you, we've not arrived. I still say some things and overload my little wagon. Somebody say amen. I have a tendency to let my mouth engage before my brain does. But I've done found out it's better for me to keep my words to myself than to ride 6 hours with a pooch lip. Somebody say me. I think that it's very important. I think the reason a lot of men never know what husbandry's about, they've never been explained. They've never been taught a real Bible message about being a man. God's made you to be a man. Now you need to pick up the role and be a man. We're running low for men in our country. We're running low on men to be in our community. And I want to remind y'all today, even though we've got a Spirit-filled church, and no doubt one of the greatest ministries in the country, but I want to remind y'all today, our church is never any stronger than what her homes are. My home needs to be challenged. My home needs to be enlightened of the teaching of the Word of God. Now, I want to say this thing of the man of I do, as Joseph said, that I do. I want to talk about, first of all, that heart of I do. Do you remember when the old preacher stood you up and he asked you some things and you, in return, said, I do? Well, he didn't mean for you to say that and just go a fishing. He didn't mean for you to say that and just go a coon hunting. He didn't mean for you to say that and go to running with the boys. Now, I know it'd get quiet, but it don't matter to me. I've been preaching where it's quiet a long time. But I want to say today, there's the heart of I do. Now, notice the vow of it. It's a very powerful vow. In Malachi chapter number 2, if you turn all the way to the right in your Old Testament, find there that great and powerful little book of Malachi. Now I want you to look in chapter 2 and verse number 11. Now I want you to look about the vow of I do. Now, marriage is God's creative plan and purpose. Marriage and family are the foundation of any healthy society, long as there is a man and a woman involved. Just not marriage, but biblical marriage between a man and a woman. Two men marrying, two women marrying are not biblical. And they not accepted in God's Bible. Now, I want to say this heart of I do. Malachi 2 and verse number 11. Judah hath dealt treacherously, and an abomination is committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. For Judah hath profaned the holiness of the Lord, which he loved, and hath married the daughter of a strange god. Now the Lord will cut off the man that doeth this. Verse 13, and this have you done again, covering the altar of the Lord with tears and weeping, and with crying out, insomuch that he regardeth not the offering any more, or receiveth it with good will at your hand. Well, you say, wherefore? Because the Lord hath been witness between thee and the wife of thy youth, against whom thou hast dealt treacherously, yet is she thy companion and the wife of thy covenant. Now, I want to say, this vow of I do is very important to God. It's powerful. Then he says in verse number 15, and he did not, he make one, yet had he the residue of the Spirit, and wherefore one, that he might seek a godly seed. Now here's my thought. Therefore take heed to your spirit, and let none deal treacherously against the wife of his youth. Now men, it's very important that we keep our spirit right. And we need to realize that in this man of I do, in this heart of I do, there is a vow involved. Secondly, there's a vesting involved. When you say, I do, it means that you do. It's personal. And I want to say it ought to be permanent. And then this vessel of I do. Now, we men are human, and I want to help us here just a minute. Not only the vow of I do and the vesting of I do, but the vessel of I do. Look in Matthew 5 and verse number 8. You don't hear this preached much anymore, but it's in our Bible and it's very important. Now this vessel of I do, it's a great principle there. God said, watch your spirit, and He said it for a reason. Now here, in the great Beatitudes, or the Sermon on the Mount, And Jesus said something in Matthew 5 and verse 8. Here it is. Underline it in your heart, sir. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Brother Joe, I want my heart pure. Brother Mike, I want my heart right. And then Jesus said something else about this vessel. In Matthew 5 and 27, just over a little bit, He said, now Jesus is talking. Jesus is talking. And not Dr. Phil talking. Now look what He says in Matthew 5:27. You ought to want to know what the Bible says about your relationship with your wife. You've heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out. Cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. Now these are the words of Christ. We need to realize that the heart of I do, there's a vow involved. When I said I do, it meant something to me personally. And it meant something heavenly. And then, not only this vow and this vesting, but this vessel, but I want to say there's a vigilance involved. Now, when you said, I do, that meant that you would be vigilant for you to be the husband of your wife. Now, number two, not only the heart of I do, and let me tell you, the reason so many marriages go wrong, it's not in your heart. You must get your wife in your heart. You must get the Lord in your heart. And I want to say that in this man of I do, not only the heart of I do, but I want you to look at the hand of I do. Now, when you grabbed her hand and said, I do, it was a hallowed hand. Now, biblical marriage between a man and a wife, it is a traditional lifestyle. Look in Romans chapter number 1 and verse 18. When we said, I do, and grabbed her hand, it was a hallowed hand. Romans 1 and verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness. Things is going on in America today, if they would get back in the Bible, I believe that it would be a lot easier on our country. We hear about the love of God, but you don't hear a lot about the wrath of God. He is a God of love, but He's also a God of wrath. He means what He says. So He says that the wrath of God's revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. He says, for the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination. Now, we're talking about the wrath of God, why the wrath of God comes. He says they wouldn't glorify Him as God, neither were thankful. In church, we ought to always remember this. Well, preacher, things are bad, but it's not as bad as what it could be. And so they were neither thankful. We ought to be a thankful Christian. We ought to be a thankful church. But because vain in their imaginations and their foolish heart was darkened. Now, I don't care what kind of idea you got today. If it don't line up with your King James Bible, I forget about my idea. Vain imaginations, professing themselves to be wise, so look what the Bible says, they become fools and change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. You better watch them little tree huggers. They'll get you in trouble. For this cause, God gave them up, look, to vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use in that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly. That word is shame. And receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. Now look, there was an error there, but in verse 28, God says, I'm going to give you a chance, and watch this. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, they said, we don't need you, God. Then God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do these things which are not convenient. Now today, this hand of I do, it's a hallowed hand, and marriage is on hallowed ground today. I think we need to be reminded just how important that when we said I do, how important that really is to your life, her life, and your children's life. And to everybody else's life. Now, the hand of I do. It's a hallowed hand. But then in Genesis 2 and 18, it's an honored hand. Now, it was no coincidence that I met my wife so many years ago in Florida on vacation with our parents. God brought her into my life. And I'm thankful that it is an honored hand. Isn't that amazing? God led me a woman that said she would be my helpmeet. She would have everything that I needed in my marriage relationship and in my home. How honored I ought to be that God would pick me out a wife. And I can tell you, God picked out Adam's wife because he went to sleep. There's a lot of you young boys, you shaking a bush on every corner trying to find your wife. You need to go to sleep in the Lord and let Him lead your wife to you. Because I'm going to tell you, He can pick out a lot better than me and you can. So wait upon the Lord and realize that it is an honored hand. In Genesis 2, verse number 18, the Lord God said it's not good that the man should be alone. I'll make him an helpmeet for him. Ma'am, are you helping or hurting your husband? Therefore, God brought them together, and we ought to be so honored, for He says in verse number 20, Adam gave names to all the cattle, the fowl of the air, to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam. and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. Not only is it a hallowed hand, but it is an honored hand. I'm thankful that God led a young lady in my life that has become my helpmate and my friend and the mother of my children. Now, I want to say in this thing of the hand of I do, it is a hallowed hand, it is an honored hand, but in Genesis 2:23, it should be a holding hand. Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called a woman, because she is taken out of man. And there shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife." Sir, you didn't marry your mother. Some of you men trying to get your wife and trying to make them to be your mama, you didn't marry your mama. I remember first time I was mama's boy. I was the baby, and I loved being the baby. She rocked me to my feet dragged the ground, and I don't apologize for that. So I moved down to Bowden, down to Georgia. So I'll never forget, we had a little single-wide trailer. And Miss Renee was going to make us a pan of biscuit. And I learned something real quick about leaving Mama that Saturday. Miss Renee made me a pan of biscuits, and she set them on the table. Now, this is how ignorant I was. I bit into them, and they run all down my shirt. And I laughed, and I said, "Well, these things won't even stay together. These ain't my mama's biscuits." So she helped me with some marriage counseling, Brother Joe. She said, "I don't think you married your mama." And so you know what she done till I think last year? She forgot about the biscuit business. We'd go down to Walmart and get them out of a froze bag and throw them in the oven. And that still does pretty good when you're in a tight. Somebody say amen. Boy, I soon found out the hurtful words I say could cut to the bone. I didn't mean it bad, but I said it. So there the Bible says that we would leave and cleave. That word means to hold on to. Let me tell you, sir, if you want to give your wife a lot of heartaches, just let your mother go try to run in your house. You be the man. Look up here. You be the boy dog and stand up and say, "The Lord's going to run our house and we're going to be good to you, but we got to cleave to one another." I don't think God never intended for folks to live together like that. Brings problems because everybody's got their own format and own responsibility. Son, won't you put on your big boy britches and just go to being a man? Doing what God called you to do and what God called you to be. And realize when you said, "I do," you pulled up to the table. First of all, you ought to get you a job. And you ought to keep your job. And you ought to be good to your wife when you come home at night. That means you need to come home at night. Now, the heart of I do, the hand of I do, it's a hallowed hand, it's an honored hand, it's a holding hand. But then thirdly and lastly, about the man of I do, his heart, his hand, but his house. I want you to turn with me in 2 Samuel chapter number 11. And I want to say this to you, daddies. Stay in the battle. Stay in the battle. Because it is a battle. The devil hates any home that is set up on the precepts of your Bible. The devil came to steal, kill, and destroy. And the devil would love to have your homes tore all to pieces. Stay in the battle. Now look at David. 2 Samuel chapter number 11 and verse 1. It came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him in all Israel. And they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. Came to pass in the evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman. And one said, "Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" And David sent messengers and took her, and she came in to him, and he lay with her. For she was purified from her uncleanliness. She returned unto her house, and the woman conceived, and sent and told David, and said, "I am with child." So a long story short, David sends to the forefront of the battle and gets Uriah, her husband, tries to bring him home, and he tries to make a cover-up of his wrong, and he gets Uriah killed. They have a child together, and the Lord took the child, and David paid for his wrongs here. Let me tell you, just because you're saved, it don't mean that you're going to have some repercussions of your doing wrong here. Now, I want to say this with this home of I do. Stay in the battle. David, the Bible said it was a time of battle. You know what David is doing? He is laying at home and he didn't get himself engaged in the battle. Can I tell you today, daddies, it is a battle going on spiritually at your house and my house. If it's ever been a time that we need to be going forth in the battle and doing battle for our wife and our children, our homes and our society, it is this morning. Marriage is difficult. It really is. When you first get married, you're not used to all this stuff. It's got to be some adapting go on. But David found himself, if he would have been in the battle instead of at home and not engaged in the battle, he found himself on some hard living. I want to say that Bathsheba had her downfalls also. She was not a conservative lady. She put herself on a rooftop and didn't cover her nakedness, and therefore the devil used that to tempt David. I want to say something as your preacher. Your husband is human. Ladies, you are human. And we ought to realize the Bible says to dress in modesty. Ladies, you ought to not be advertising yourself the way you dress yourself. Now, a lot of you say, "Well, preacher, you need to get with the program." No, you need to cover up your nakedness. We need to cover up when we go to the hardware store, flea market, and we show our Lord need to cover up when we come to the house of God. Now listen, honey, your dress ain't got to drag the ground. And sir, you ain't even got to wear a tie to come to this church, but just let me ask you, just wear your best. just be clean. We ought to want to serve the Lord and put on our Sunday's best. I went and visited an old timer yesterday, Brother David, out in the community. He's 80-something years old. I stopped, he and his wife on the porch, and I told him I'd been up in the Carolinas preaching revival. He said, "How many nights did you go?" I said, "I went through Thursday night." He said, "I never will forget down in Salem Baptist in our community here in Bowden," said, "meeting broke out," and said, "the men said, now we need to have a meeting Saturday night too." And he said, I'll never forget what one old man in the community said. He said, "We can't meet Saturday, that's tub night." Well, we ought to clean up ourselves. Comb our hair if you got some. If not, just cut it off real short. Brush your teeth. Somebody, your neighbor appreciate that. Somebody say amen. And we got some breath mints in the prayer room there in a big party bowl. Help yourself. But I want to say that I see both here. Now, I want to say something, men. I want to say it out of your preacher's heart. Let me tell you something. Y'all need a preacher in your life. You don't need a politician. We got plenty of them boys and girls running. You need a preacher. And I want to say something. He can't blame his wrong and his lust on Bathsheba. He was to deal with that himself. Sir, you're not going to make everybody not tempt you. And you better be sure, if you are a man, look up here. You can be tempted by a woman. Watch what you look at. Watch where you go. And I want you to realize this. If you would brag on your wife as much as you do other women, things may pick up down at your house. Boy, look yonder. What you looking at? I'm looking at that woman crossing the road. Your wife sitting there in the car. Why, she ought to throw a song book at you right now. I mean, no, I don't mean not right now. Let me get done preaching. David cannot blame his wrong on somebody else. It's time that we take actions for ourselves and quit blaming it on everybody else. That's like these boys rob stores and say the police shoots them. Well, you dummy, if you rob people, you're going to jail. It ain't the police's fault. So we got to take responsibility for ourselves. I want to say this, men, stay in the battle. Do you not realize it's a battle? It is a battle that the devil is fighting against you. And let me tell you, the flesh is fighting against you. You say, "Well, my wife said she don't even smile at me." Well, let me ask you, feller, something. The way you guide her, did you get her by staying on the riverbank all day? Did you get her by running with the boys all the time? Or did you take some time out to date her some? I hope you did. Look, some of y'all, I don't know if you did or not. You ought to brag on your wife. Miss Renee reminds me about it. I need to be reminded. She got in the car this morning, had on a white jacket and a long blue and white matching skirt. It was time for me to say, "Hon, you look pretty this morning." She went to a meeting with me at church the other night, and she... getting ready to go into church, I said, "Honey, you're just extra pretty tonight." You know, everybody like folks to brag on them a little bit. I'm not talking about getting in pride, but sir, the way that you got your wife, you got to keep that kind of atmosphere up to keep your wife. Oh, he's like, "I can tell by looking." Some of you young men, I just sit back and look at you, and this is what I think. I used to be crazy like that. So, I want to say, stay in the battle. There's a battle against the flesh, against the devil, and there's a big battle against this world. It's amazing to me. You remember the other Sunday, I preached a minute about the heritage of our parents and our grandparents that we have buried and they went on to meet the Lord. They didn't listen to me. It is what it is. And I'm preaching in this day and this hour, and I've realized this. Our culture is different. We have allowed things from the world to come at us, and they promote this kind of bad lifestyle. And if you're not careful, you'll pattern yourself after the world. But Jesus gave us a Bible. Stay in the battle. I bet you David wish he'd stayed in the battle. Ladies, you know what you need to do? If you would learn to encourage your husband and don't embarrass your husband in front of other people. That just tires me up. Have your private conversations. I've seen folks just have a fight out in a church parking lot. Take your fight home. We don't want to see it or smell it. It's a battle. Ladies, you ought to encourage him to stay in the battle. You, ladies, I'm going to tell you what, you might be surprised. You might be surprised if you started encouraging and quit nagging so much what he would do. Y'all don't like that point? You know, a fella gets tired of just being harped on all the time. But I want to say something. If you're spending more time with the boys and in the woods than you are with your wife, then I want to say something to you, sir, and I want to say something to your wife. First of all, sir, God wants you to be a man at your house. We all need time that we enjoy things. But ma'am, I want to ask you something. Are you nagging him so much that he don't want to spend no time with you? Hey, turn me off just a minute off this radio. I got to say something on a family matter. Husband, you've got to hold it together. And it's your responsibility to be the man that God called you to be. Because your children and a society is counting on you. Stay in the battle. Number two, stay in the Bible. Stay in the battle. It's a battle. Every week it's a battle. You got to go to figuring it out and trying to work on something, but it's a battle. The devil don't want you at church. Ain't it amazing? You don't have no problem going nowhere. You start trying to go to church. It's a battle. We need the Lord in our lives. Stay in the battle. Psalms 119, stay in the Bible. Psalms 119, I'm about done. Psalms 119, verse number 9, stay in the Bible. It's amazing what we find if we'll just read the directions. Any of y'all like me and try to put something together and then it don't fit and you say, well, where's the instructions? Me and CC putting deer stands together. I throw some wrenches in there, Brother Gerald, got the jerking stuff, unwrapping it, and got it all put together. I said, this don't look right. CC said, where's the instructions? Psalms 119, verse 9, only verse I'm going to read out of this thought. Wherewith shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed, therefore, according to thy word. Stay in the battle. Let me tell you, sir, it's worth staying in the battle. Because it is a fight. Stay in the battle. Stay in the Bible. In Ephesians 5, I want to close with this thought. Stay in the bridle. Stay in the bridle. What are you talking about? Stay in your marriage bonds and precepts. In Ephesians chapter number 5, verse 1, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. That right there would cure a lot of houses at this church this morning. Just submitting yourselves one to another. It's not always my way, sir. And it's not always your way. Your wife's got feelings. Miss Sherry, if you come this morning, I just want you to play. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as unto the Lord. And sir, she might be willing to listen to you in a little bit better if you'd treat her with respect. For the husband's the head of the wife, and is Christ the head of the church, and He's the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be their own husbands in everything. Now here it is, verse 25. Husbands, stay in the bridle. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself for. Some of your wives have made some big mistakes. But I'm going to tell you something. So have I in my life, but God has forgiven me. God said to forgive one another, for as Christ's sake hath forgiven you. You're going to have to learn to get out of that past and take hold of your home and lead them to God. You better learn that you need to stay in the battle. The other night, and the older some of you men get, the more you're going to realize the place that your preacher had in his heart so true. Jason and Megan flew out to Texas for their anniversary Friday, and so we kept Sophie Friday night. Got ready to be bedtime. Well, Sophie jumped up in them covers, had her little lammy and had her blanket. Renee fixed her a little spot. You know what she said, Brother Joe? She said, "Pop, I love spending the night with you and Mimi." I'm going to tell you, there's been times, and I'm going to say this as your preacher, and there's some good women here. I mean, there's some finest people here that a man would ever get to pastor, and I thank God He's allowed me to do it. But I tell you what y'all do. My wife's got some situations. She's got some things she can work on, but I'm going to tell you what. Honey, I don't want to brag on you too much. The devil will destroy a home. But I'm going to tell you something. Renee Bowman's a good woman. She's had to forgive me of things where I've overloaded my mouth, and she's just prayed for me. But I sure am glad that we've stayed in the battle, because it's been a battle 37 years. It's a battle. You'd think the older you get, and this thing about the older we get, we even think alike. We say the same thing about what we want to do and go and do, be this. But I want to say something. It's a battle. You know why it's a battle? Because I'm in it. It ain't her most of the time. It's me. It's me most of the time. If I would have went to the teachings of this book, I'm going to tell you, my wife would have had a lot better days behind us than what she's had. And I'm just being honest with you. I was so high-geared, high-strung, my way or the highway, but I'm learning a few things. I want to ask you something today, sir. Your preacher's preaching on marriage. How's yours? Miss Sherry's going to play. Maybe you need some help with your marriage. Why don't you grab a hold to God? Grab a hold of your wife this morning. Make your way down around an old-fashioned altar and ask God to help you with your house. Wouldn't it be anybody want to do that this month? I mean, be that concerned about their home, that preacher. I want God to help me in my house. I want to open this altar this month. I don't know what you need. But I can tell you this, there's a whole lot of people counting on you and me to stay in the battle. To stay in the Bible. Stay in the bridle.